6 a.m. and right now on Denver 7 News, thousands of students across the metro are waking up to return to remote learning.
Elementary schools like this one will only have the youngest students in their seats today. We'll tell you what parents of older students are being told to do.
Plus, it's the countdown to Election Day.
It's time for Donald Trump to pack his bags and go home.
We are going to win the state of Michigan again.
Hours before the polls close in Colorado, businesses prepare for the worst.
We're going to board up our windows again before the election.
And this is just the latest obstacle small businesses will have to overcome in what has been a difficult year. Good Monday morning. Thanks for starting your week with us. I'm Molly Hendrickson.
And I'm Brian Sanders. The weather, at least, will not get in the way of Election Day, at least here in Colorado. Meteorologist Lisa Hidalgo is in her home weather center looking at a very nice week, all week long, really.
Yeah, all week long for the next 3 to 5 days, it's going to be highs in the 70s and some beautiful mornings like this. And now with that time change, getting that sunrise now an hour earlier. So on the eastern plains, you can see just how clear and sunny it is this morning. It's going to be a bright eastbound drive. Your dog walking forecast early on is going to be pretty mild. We should be by about 8 o'clock in the mid to upper 40s. And then we'll drop down after sunset back into the 60s. And again, we're going to hit that high now an hour earlier. So today looking at highs right around 70 to about 75 over the northeastern corner of the state. Beautiful all week. We are tracking a change this weekend, a cold front and some mountain snow. We'll take a closer look at that coming up in a few minutes.
Really, the drive looks pretty nice. No weather worries for us here this morning. We have a pretty smooth ride out of the Denver Tech Center, even though we did have a crash reported on the northbound side of I-25 going between Colorado Boulevard and University. Now from the camera there, it looks like we're looking to the northbound side. So that's northbound traffic, southbound traffic. And there was a car off to the shoulder right by the St. Paul's Bridge, which is going to be or Steel Street Bridge right there between University and Colorado Boulevard. I'm not seeing any delays, really significant delays. And you can see how the travel times right now out of the Denver Tech Center, maybe an extra minute or so, just as people are slowing down around there to look at that one car that's off to the side. But I-70 looks great. 47 in Havana, a report of a crash over there, not causing any really significant delays. Really around town, it looks pretty nice.
Thousands more students across the metro are making the switch back to remote learning today. Third through fifth graders in Denver will make the switch because of a spike in new COVID cases. Westminster and Inglewood students will also return to online learning today. Denver 7's Nicole Brady joins us live this morning. And Nicole, some parents are so upset about the back and forth, they plan to protest with a logout of sorts.
You could call it that, Brian. Yes, they'll protest today by boycotting online learning. Basically, organizers are telling parents of DPS third through fifth graders to just not log on to school today. Now, DPS did not respond to that directly on Friday. They did not say what they think about this boycott. And we don't know right now if parents are planning to extend the boycott beyond just today. So we'll have to watch and see. But on Friday, families staged a more traditional visible protest, I should say, outside district headquarters. DPS said that the return to remote learning is necessary to stop community spread of COVID and minimize disruptions to classrooms. But many parents told us they feel the district, the city, and the state are making the wrong trade-offs to deal with rising COVID cases.
Where are our priorities? You know, do they lie in keeping the bars open? Do they lie in keeping the shopping malls open? Or do they lie with our children's education and those 86,000 kids every day who aren't participating in our state's education program? It's a tragedy.
DPS kindergarten through second graders will still be learning in person for now. Other districts are taking it a step further, though. Westminster and Inglewood schools are returning all grades to remote learning starting today for at least the next 2 weeks. Adams 12 went the opposite direction. They decided to keep elementary kids in person, despite the fact that Adams County has the highest COVID case numbers in the metro. Cherry Creek schools, Douglas County schools, and Jeffco Public Schools have not made any changes for now, but I've already spoken to Jeffco parents who are already pleading with their district not to close schools because they're worried that's going to happen. All of the counties that we've mentioned have cases rising right now. We're live in Denver this morning. Nicole Brady, Denver 7.
And sadly, reports of new coronavirus infections are not slowing down across our state. Our positivity rate is more than 9%, which is well above the 5% threshold to keep the virus under control. More than 2,500 new cases were reported yesterday. The number number of hospital beds held steady through the weekend. Right now, 788 beds are in use by coronavirus patients or those suspected of having the virus. And across the country, every state except for Nebraska and Delaware is seeing a rise in cases. White House Task Force member Dr. Deborah Birx says at least a third of the country is now considered a hot spot. We're now averaging 80,000 cases per day in the U.S.
This morning, the city of Denver will open an emergency operations center in preparation of expected unrest following tomorrow's election. Businesses are already boarding up their windows in what is a sad and nerve-wracking sight. Denver 7's Micah Smith is live along the 16th Street Mall in Denver, and the city and business owners just trying to err on the side of caution here.
Well, Brian, actually, this really wasn't necessarily something that business owners came to on their own. We talked to several businesses that were boarded up, and they told us this is something the city told them to do. And even though city leaders say there's not been any official announcement of planned unrest or protests, the city reached out to business owners telling them to secure their property and be prepared to dial 911 if anyone damages their property. And I will say there are a lot of businesses that are not boarded up. Now, this isn't the only preemptive step the city is taking. For the first time ever ahead of an election, the police department is launching a command post and will open an emergency operations center to, quote, monitor activity related to the election and support election and public safety teams. So while the city focuses on the possibility of civil unrest, state leaders are focused on the possibility of a historic election for our state. Colorado is on the verge of historic voter turnout, not just within the state, but the entire country. So far, 2.5 million Coloradans have cast their ballot. That's about 59% of eligible voters, and that's about 88% that is, of total voter turnout in 2016. And if Colorado continues on this path, the election director for the state says we could reach 80% voter turnout, and we would be the first state in the United States to do so. Reporting live, Micah Smith, Denver 7.
All right, thank you, Micah. Nationwide, meanwhile, Democrats are dominating early voting. At least 92 million people have voted early. Democratic voters account for 48% of those cast so far. Republicans account for 41%. This is all according to a Democratic elections data firm called Target Smart. Unaffiliated voters make up 10% of early voting.
A big question surrounding this election is whether results will be contested. One of President Trump's re-election campaign's top advisors suggested there could be a legal battle if votes are still being counted after Election Day.
If you speak with many smart Democrats, they believe that President Trump will be ahead on election night, probably getting 280 electorals, somewhere in that range. And then they're going to try to steal it back after the election.
Votes in the U.S. are always counted after Election Day. News organizations will project winners Tuesday night based on the partial counts, but states never report final results on election night. They aren't legally required to do so. Electoral votes aren't awarded until December. And if you're waiting to vote tomorrow and you need help with your ballot, we have our complete election guide right now on thedenverchannel.com. And tomorrow, stay with Denver 7 throughout election night for 360 coverage. We will have local cut-ins every half hour, plus live coverage on Roku, Android, Amazon Fire, and Apple TV from 6 to 11 p.m. Just search Denver 7 on your streaming device.
Heartbreaking sight here. Firefighters in Grand County took a Denver 7 crew inside the fire lines to give us a first look at the extent of the damage from the East Troublesome fire. And you can see a lot of buildings just reduced to ruins. For Paul Hedgecock and his son, they sifted through what was the old bait shop at the Highland Marina at Lake Granby.
All these people that had their little trailers here, that they loved coming here. It's really sad. It's my whole life. Been here since I was 16 years old.
Several boats and RVs also destroyed. More than 300 homes damaged or destroyed in Grand County. Right now, victims are waiting for insurance adjusters to come up and survey the damage they say they can't clean up until that happens. Meanwhile, new progress is being made on the Cameron Peak fire burning in Larimer County, the largest in state history. Firefighters say it could be fully contained by Sunday. Containment on the Williams Fork fire, also burning in Grand County, rose to 74%. That's a big jump. You can still donate to our Denver 7 Gives Fund for families who have lost so much during the wildfire season. Just head to thedenverchannel.com, click Denver 7 Gives, and then under the drop-down menu, select Help Colorado Wildfire Victims. So far, you've helped us raise more than $220,000.